In the last video, we explained the intuitive notion of a point of inflection, but we did not get into a lot of the algebra as far as how you actually find a point of inflection for a function. So that's what we're going to do in this video. A quick reminder on what a point of inflection is. It's a place where where a function's continuous and where it changes concavity. So if you look at this picture here, we'll illustrate some things that it is and things that it isn't. This graph starts off concave down, if you see right here in red, but there comes a time where it switches about where my cursor is, where it switches from concave down to being concave up. Now we would call that transition place right here in the middle. We would call this yellow dot or what's in this yellow square. We'd call that a point of inflection because it changes concavity from down to concave up and it's continuous there. You don't pick up your pencil through this point. Now then there's an asymptote. Now notice currently it's concave up in blue, but after the asymptote it switches to be concave down again. So now the question would be right here at the asymptote, would we call that a point of inflection? Because technically it does change concavity there. And the answer is no, we would not call that a point of inflection. Why? Because it's not continuous there. So that's why that word is in there. It has to be continuous at every particular point that's a possible point of inflection. Now later in the function, it's concave down and then it switches to be concave up. We would call this place right here, we would call that a point of inflection. So basically it's a place where your function changes concavity with the caveat that it has to be continuous there. So it's something you have to watch out for. Now using algebra, if there wasn't a graph, how do we find a point of inflection? Well, I'm going to go through some steps and I'll actually do an example while we're going through the steps. To find a point of inflection, I'm going to abbreviate that POI for short. First of all, determine where the second derivative is zero or doesn't exist. And the reason that is because you can't go from a negative second derivative that's concave down to a positive second derivative that's concave up without going through zero. That's the only way of going from negatives to positives, unless there's an abrupt change, in which case the second derivative likely would not exist. So that's why we find all these places where it's zero, because that's the likely places where it's going to change from concave up to down or vice versa. All right, and then we'll find where f is concave up or down by using a number line. So a little bit of this is recapped from the concavity videos where we do some examples and explain concavity. Matter of fact, I used a similar example, or I think it was this example, in another video. But if we have, as an example, x to the fourth minus 4x cubed, then the first derivative will be 4x cubed minus 12x squared. And the second derivative will be 12x squared minus 24x, just using our derivative rules. If we set that equal to zero, this left-hand side factors, and we would get solutions of x equals zero or x equals two. Now, does this mean that zero and two are 100% points of inflection? No, those two are places where the second derivative is zero, so you can call them likely points of inflection, or what I prefer to say is possible points of inflection. We have possible POIs or points of inflection at zero and two. We have to verify it though. We have to understand that that's not 100%. There are examples, not in this video, but there are examples out there where you can get a second derivative being zero at a number and it not be a point of inflection. It does happen. So we're going to put 0 and 2 on a number line. And just because it's not really the point of this video, I went ahead and sped through the algebra in regards to finding concavity. What I did was I chose test points before 0, between 0 and 2, and after 2, namely negative 1, 1, and 3. And I plugged them in the second derivative function. And without going through the algebra, I got a positive answer, a negative answer, and then a positive answer. What that means is because the second derivative was positive before zero, it's concave up. Between zero and two, it was negative. That means it's concave down. And after two, it was concave up. Now, look at these numbers here. Look at zero and two. Can we now call them points of inflection? Yes, we can, for two reasons. Number one, it changes concavity from up to down or down to up. Either way is fine. It changes concavity. So by definition, they're points of inflection as long as it's continuous. And knowing just what type of function this is, it's just a polynomial of degree four. It has no asymptotes. It has no jumps or holes in it. It'll be continuous. So these are definitively now points of inflection. I threw in a graph here just to illustrate this. Before zero, it was concave up. And then after zero, but before two, it was concave down. And then after two, it looks like it was concave up again. So we were able to determine the concavity without the aid of the graph. So that's pretty nice to be able to do this. And we also realized that zero and two are points of inflection where it changes concavity.